How to Raise Your Adult Children, Because Big Kids Have Even Bigger Problems, by Gail Parent and Susan Ende, MFT. Narrated by Karen White. Copyright 2010 by Gail Parent and Susan Ende. This unabridged audiobook is published by arrangement with Hudson Street Press, a member of Penguin Group USA Incorporated, and was produced in the year 2010 by Tantor Media Incorporated, which holds the copyright thereto. Introduction. Should you lend your son money? Do you pay for his medical insurance when he can't? Do you dare comment on how your child is raising her child? When your adult child gets in trouble and can't afford a lawyer, do you hire one for him? What happens when your gay son and his partner adopt a baby and his partner leaves him? What if your daughter is on her way to becoming obese? There are millions of questions parents have when dealing with their adult children. Until now, there have been very few answers. But this book will tell you how to get along with your grown children and, along the way, help them become strong, independent adults. The idea for the book was formulated on a trip that we and our husbands took together. The men enjoyed the scenery, and we women talked about our children in 7 different countries. Since we missed the scenery, we bought postcards. We wished there were a guide for parents like us, so we decided to write one. That's how to Raise Your Adult Children was born. Figuring out the right format for the book was the most difficult part of the process. We tried answering the questions together, but that didn't work. Gail tended to have more practical advice. A lot of it came from her mother. As a comedic author, she also wanted to throw in a few punchlines. Susan's answers were serious and rooted in psychology. She knew the behavior problems hidden in every question. We then decided to answer the questions separately, which worked. Many times we agree, sometimes we don't, but the answers are always presented from 2 unique points of view. Where did the questions come from? Everywhere. We started close to home, gathering questions from friends and relatives. Then they told their friends and relatives who contacted us, until eventually we began to receive questions from strangers. The day we heard that a friend of a friend of a friend had followed our advice and it worked, we knew we were in business. Writing a book is interesting, fun, and frustrating, but once we got into it, we kept our goal in mind. We wanted people to gain insight and stop walking on eggshells with their adult children. We both knew that what Gail's mother had taught her was true. When kids are little, they have little problems. When they are big, they have big problems. We wanted to be able to help our readers be there for the big problems, but not cause them. When our children are young, we feed and dress them. When they are old enough, we expect them to feed and dress themselves. We teach them to ride bikes and later to drive cars so they can move further and further away from us on their own steam. We make sure they have the right skills and know the rules of the road before sending them off to practice getting themselves around, independent of us. We worry, but we let them go anyway. We should do the same thing when our kids are adults, especially regarding money. Money is the currency of adult life. By the time a kid leaves college, he should have mastered the skills of budgeting, financial planning, delayed gratification, working, spending wisely, and saving for a rainy day. College is a good time to practice those skills. We shouldn't send money on demand or bail a kid out. This is an area parents sometimes forget about when raising adult kids. Our children can't be independent unless they are supporting themselves, and they have to master the skills to do it. Nor are they independent unless they live on their own. Living with us or in our guest room is not living independently. Living on one's own is a developmental step, just the way driving a car is. We need to expect and prepare our children to live on their own after they leave school. It should be part of what a parent teaches his child to do. He can practice in college when we're usually still paying the bills. When our children become adults, we need to rethink and rewrite our relationships with them. We need to treat them as adults and expect them to behave like adults. When our children are independent, we have no control over them. Independent children can make their own decisions about their lives, their money, and who they choose as friends and romantic partners. We also need to accept that when our children are adults, the configuration of the family changes. The children no longer live with us, and we are no longer the primary relationship in their lives. They have their own personal lives that are more important to them than their families are. We and our adult children are separate. Our child is on his own life journey, which is different from ours. His may take him to another state, to a different lifestyle from ours. He is his own person, not an extension of mom and dad. Although we raised him with our values, to be truly separate from us, our child has to develop his own value system. His value system will be influenced not only by us, but also by his peers and his own reading and thinking. So his values may in various ways be different from ours. We need to recognize the differences and accept them, even if we don't like or admire them. If not, we could lose the relationship with our child. So, our primary focus when answering the questions in this book was to point parents in the direction of making decisions to foster their child's independence. It's all too easy to get into the mode of reacting to the problem of the moment without looking at the long-term issues. Unless the house is burning down, in which case we should react instantly and call 911, we should think through decisions before we make them. Fostering independence should be our goal, and we should make our decisions from that perspective. We, like many others, thought that when our kids left home, our parenting days were over. We quickly learned that they weren't. How to Raise Your Adult Children is here to help. This book answers questions that most parents never imagined they would have to ask. Chapter 1. Money. Money is a big subject when it comes to adult children. The question of whether mom and dad should pay for something comes up over and over. It's tempting to want to avoid thinking about money until we have to, then make the most comfortable decision and hope for the best. But that's not the mature way to handle the money subject. A better way is to use some principles to guide our money choices that help our children become maturely functioning adults. First, a child who is dependent always feels ambivalent toward the person he's dependent on. We may think that if we provide our child with what he needs and make him dependent on us, he will feel secure. But dependence, in reality, means lack of security, because the one you're dependent on has control over your destiny. Being dependent means you're not free. Therefore, dependence always breeds some resentment. Parents should want their children to be independent. The reality is that no one is truly independent unless he is financially independent. Being able to fully support yourself boosts self-esteem and self-confidence. Knowing that you can take care of yourself no matter what means security. A parent's goal for his adult child should be financial independence. But even if we agree to this precept, we can get lost putting it into action. The pitfall for the child is that being taken care of financially feels familiar and appealing. Being on his own can be frightening. So why not go with the known rather than the unknown? Why not hold on to mom and dad's purse strings? Although our child may seem to have a healthy thrust toward financial autonomy, he may also have a hidden wish to be taken care of. We have to remember that the purse strings, like the umbilical cord, need to be cut. and since the purse is ours, we have to do the cutting. The pitfall for us as parents is the fantasy that if our child needs our money, he will love us and be grateful. Actually, it's just the opposite. The parent who provides the money is the source of the child's shame and self-doubt. Really, it's a vicious cycle. If the child doesn't have confidence in himself, he falls back on dependence, and being dependent fosters insecurity and anxiety, and so the circle goes around. Second, the boundaries between a parent's money and an adult child's should be clear. Children are not entitled to mom and dad's money. They are not even entitled to inherit it. Parents can do whatever they want with their money. Likewise, parents are not entitled to their child's money. Parents are not entitled to spend all their money, even if it's on their child, and then expect him to support them. In the same vein, children are not entitled to tell parents how to spend their money, nor are parents entitled to tell their child how to spend his. Third, our expectations regarding money should be known. If parents plan to pay for college, they should tell their kid. But if parents can't or don't want to, they should be precise about what they will spend, if anything, and expect the child to deal with the limitations, get a job during high school or college. The same goes for weddings. Going into debt to pay for a wedding is irresponsible. But what if you want to give your child money? It's better to give a gift than a loan. Children who need money are not likely to be able to pay off a loan. It's human nature to be anxious about a debt you can't pay, and to want to stay clear of the person you owe money to. It's also important to remember that parents should not give what they can't afford. Parents also need to be vigilant about not using money for control. Parents shouldn't want to control their adult children and shouldn't use money to try to. That's why a gift is better than a loan. If mom and dad lend their kid money for a car, they are more likely to want a say in the choice and be angry when their child doesn't make a prudent purchase. And very importantly, parents shouldn't let their child try to control them with money, or, more likely, his lack of it. Just because the job of his dreams hasn't come along does not mean that his parents should support him. Finally, parents should be careful not to confuse love with money. Our love for our child should motivate us to help him become independent, which sometimes means that the best thing we can do for our kid is to not give him a cent. Save me from my son. Dear Gail and Susan, I own a nice-sized furniture business that I inherited from my father. We sell good quality merchandise, and I like that we have personal relationships with our customers in the community. My son Malcolm has an MBA and worked for a big company for a few years. Now he wants me to take him into my business. He thinks that we should expand, buy from cheaper Asian markets, and eventually have a chain of stores. As his father, how can I refuse him? My father took me into the business. Can I do any less for my son? It's not as if he isn't qualified. He has his MBA and business experience. I have been having sleepless nights, and my ulcer is acting up since he proposed this idea. I don't like thinking that my life is going to change to the extent that it would. My wife tells me it's only my fear and depression-era mentality that's creating a problem, and she says I owe it to my son, Cyrus. Dear ulcerated Cyrus, your father left you his business. In turn, you can leave it to your son. However, you don't have to let him mess it up while you are still alive. Right now, the business seems to be doing fine. Malcolm might have an MBA, but he is not recognizing that bigger may not be better. While you may not have an advanced degree, you certainly know how to run your business, and you used to know how to sleep. Keep it small. You and your son are at different stages of life. He's willing to take risks. You're not. That's normal. I love normal. Self-employed, Gail. Gail, Parents are obligated to raise their children until the children are legally allowed to be on their own. Parents are not even obligated to pay for college, although many do as an investment in their child's future. Parents are definitely not obligated to provide a business for their children, qualified or not. Likewise, though a parent might want a child to join the family business, the child is not obligated to do so. What our parents did for us is not binding on what we do for our children. Every adult gets to decide for himself, because every situation is different. If Cyrus does not want to change his life for his son's ambition, he shouldn't have to. Malcolm has other options, and if he is that good a businessman, he will find a business to build on his own. Susan. Big Daddy. Dear Gail and Susan, my husband and I often go out for meals with my daughter and son-in-law, and my husband always picks up the check. Neither my son-in-law nor my daughter ever offers. My husband says we can afford it, so no harm, no foul, and that he enjoys playing Big Daddy. It makes me uncomfortable to be out with adults whom we treat like children. Who's right? Robin. Robin, you're right, but so what? Your husband wants to retain some sort of control and respect, but what are you going to do? Change the guy or fight with him? Big Daddy is Big Daddy and you've got him. In some families, the parents are Santa Claus to their children their whole lives. It's only really harmful when the kids expect more than a dinner out. I feel I can't buy my kids groceries all the time or pay their mortgages, but that I can treat them to dinner at a nice restaurant. I'm guilty of always picking up the check when I'm out with them. Please write to me again and let me know what no foul really means. Does it mean no chicken or turkey? Gail, who likes taking her kids out. Well, Gail, we don't agree on this one. When our children become adults, we should treat them like adults who are our equals now. We need to change the way we relate. Parents who routinely pick up the tab may feel good about it, but paying all the time does nothing for the adult child's self-esteem, nor for his sense of finally being an equal. It's time for Big Daddy to step down from being Big Daddy and let his kids in on the feelings of adult power. Parents' personal power shouldn't come from having power over their children. Parents shouldn't think that they lose their personal power when they allow their grown children to have theirs. That's not to say that a parent can't occasionally treat, but as a regular practice, the adults can split the bill or take turns paying. By the way, Gail, in basketball, if you hit a player's arm but he makes the basket anyway, a foul may not be called because it didn't do the shooter any harm. No harm, no foul. Susan. Margaret's Mess. Dear Gail and Susan, I'm very well off financially. My 45-year-old daughter Patricia is a high earner with two children. Her soon-to-be ex was a stay-at-home dad. Now that they are divorcing, he wants a large alimony settlement and custody of the children. Given their arrangement, he has a case. My daughter's legal bills are enormous, more than she can really afford. I have offered her money, but she refuses to take it. She says that she would rather sell her house. I don't understand her. Any money I give her, I would leave to her anyway. She may as well have it now. How can I bring her to her senses? Margaret. Margaret, you crazy mother, you. How can you bring her to her senses? How can I bring you to your senses? Your daughter is a grown-up and she knows it. That's why she is refusing to take money from you. If she sells her house and moves into an apartment, the time will come when she no longer has legal bills and she can buy another house since she's a big earner. From the time I was 21, I was embarrassed to take money from my parents. Your daughter is 45. She must be embarrassed, too. I like her. Let her have her pride. Gail, who didn't take money from her parents, but cried easily until she was 50. Margaret's daughter is facing an increasingly common, stressful situation. Some women are now paying alimony, but that's because they earn more than their husbands do. To Patricia's credit, she is not clinging to her old life at all costs and is willing to sell her house to pay her bills. A divorce means a change in life. Some people want to hang on to the house when it is not financially realistic to do so. Margaret should not get in the way of Patricia's taking care of business, responsibly and independently. I hope that Margaret comes to understand that her daughter is handling her divorce, including the legal bills, very competently. Susan. Rehab, repeat. Dear Gail and Susan, my 36-year-old son is a drug addict. I have paid for rehab twice. He stays clean for a while and then goes back to using. Should I pay for another rehab? I so want to see him have a normal life. What should I do? William. William, father of an addict. Right. Pay for another rehab. Then pay again and again. Hasn't reading the Inquirer taught you anything? What happens to drug addicts if their fathers don't send them to endless rehabs? They commit a couple of crimes to get money to keep their habit going and are jailed for a couple of years where they can't get drugs. Incarceration may not be the best way to get over an addiction, but most of the time, it works. Have a nice day. Your tell-it-like-it-is woman, Gail. In my opinion, rehab is a misnomer. Rehab should be called detox because no one leaves rehab, which is usually 1 month long, recovered from his addiction. He may not be drinking nor doing drugs, and he may have some better coping tools to take with him. But true rehabilitation takes a commitment to an ongoing treatment program and to never taking drugs. A parent might consider paying for one rehab detox to give his son or daughter the opportunity to begin to deal with his addiction. If the child does not pursue the path that rehab detox sets out, then a parent should not pay again. To an addict, rehab repeatedly paid for by parents is just another fix. Getting over an addiction requires a whole new way of life. William's son has to do that work, and he should pay the price. William says that he wants his son to have a normal life. I certainly understand the pain a parent feels when a child is in the grips of a drug. Sadly, though, William cannot force or pay his son to sobriety. His son has to want that for himself. Susan. Jake, the gigolo. Dear Gail and Susan, my wife and I give our 28-year-old son Jake a tax-free gift of $13,000 a year, which he uses for petty cash. His other money comes from older women he latches on to. He moves in with them. These women buy him expensive gifts and take him with them when they travel. There have been several of these relationships. His mother and I are shocked. We didn't raise Jake to take advantage of people, much less to live the life of a gigolo. Is there anything we can do? Sam. Dearest Sam, the way I see it, there's only one thing you can do. Take away the $13,000 yearly gift. Without that, Jake won't be able to take older women out to dinner or give them little gifts. I'm sure that's what he does when he meets them, so you have to take away his seduction power. Do this sooner rather than later. Without any money, he'll have to work. Like everyone else, gigolos have expenses. They need decent haircuts and good clothes, not to mention they have to smell good. You have to see to it that he has none of those things. You might also drop a hint that he's out of your will. Your sympathizer, Gail. Gail, I agree with you, although I would frame it differently. Jake has a financial system made up of his parents' funding and his lady's generosity. Sam and his wife can refuse to finance a system they don't approve of, just as parents might not give money to a child who used it for heroin. Susan. Josh, the writer. Dear Gail and Susan, my son Josh is married with two children. He's been a successful dentist for years. Last week, Josh told us that he is unhappy with his career choice. He feels that he has a creative side that isn't being given expression. Josh wants to take a year off and give himself the chance to see if he can make it as a writer. The problem is that Josh and his wife Marcy have pretty much lived on their income, have little in savings, and Marcy doesn't work. Marcy said she would get a job. Even if she did, though, we know she could not earn enough to cover their expenses. Big house, country club membership, nice cars, private school, etc. Josh has asked if we could either help support him or lend him the money. His argument is that it's money we would leave him anyway. In other words, could he have some of his inheritance now so he can have a chance at realizing his dream? I thought you and Susan were the perfect people to advise me on what to do. John. John, father of Josh. Yes, Josh can take the year off and focus on his writing, but he can't do it with your money. He's got to cut down his expenses, buy a smaller house, drop the country club, put the kids in public school, and get rid of the nice cars. Once he has enough money in the bank, he could take a year off to become a writer. His dream has got to be funded by him, or he could write on nights and weekends. That's the better choice. He won't have time to think about what he's missing at the country club. Promise me, John, that you're going to stay out of this. Take it from someone who knows. Writing isn't something you want to do. Writing is something you have to do. Gail, who wrote in her spare time at the beginning. Gail, there are several red flags waving in this letter. First, if Josh just wanted to express his creative side, he would take a painting or writing class at his local college. But that's not what he means, is it? What Josh really wants to do is realize his dream of being a successful writer, and he wants to do it in 1 year. Building any career, and writing is harder than most, takes more than a year. Unless Josh writes a best-selling novel or a blockbuster screenplay, he won't be making a sufficient income at the end of 1 year to support his lifestyle. Josh doesn't have a realistic career plan. He has a grandiose fantasy that he wants his family to buy into. Second, ambition, any ambition, in this case, to become a successful writer, requires personal sacrifice. In Josh's plan, his wife Marcy will sacrifice being a stay-at-home mom and go to work. His mother and father will sacrifice some of their money. Nowhere do we hear that Josh intends to make any sacrifice for his ambition. If Josh wants to try his hand at writing, he can write before or after work or on weekends. He can join a writing group. He can find out if he has any talent. If he is ever able to support his lifestyle with his writing, he can quit his job. Josh and his wife should put no money toward Josh's childish, unrealistic scheme. Susan. Gary and Ginny. Dear Gail and Susan, I am in a second marriage. I have two children, as does my wife Ginny. The problem is that she is much wealthier than I, and so her children live a much more privileged life than mine do. Her kids have gone to the best schools, drive fancy cars, and take luxury trips. Mine go to state schools, drive hand-me-down clunkers, and have never been out of the country. I feel depressed about my inability to give to my children what my wife can give to hers. I think my children feel like second-class citizens. I suppose I do, too. Any suggestions? Gary. Dear Gary with the inferiority complex, I do have a suggestion. Stop feeling depressed about your inability to give to your children. Children who aren't given everything make better adults. They are more appreciative of what they can do for themselves rather than what their parents handed them. My answer is short but smart. Gail, sometimes the mother of us all. That's not fair. Gail, that's what a young child says when his older sister gets a bigger bicycle than he does. Actually, when a child complains that something isn't fair, He really means that he doesn't get the same as someone else. Part of our job as parents is to help our young children understand that we don't all get the same. Gary seems not to have learned that concept. He is still caught up in childish rivalry and envy about material acquisitions and luxury experiences. Blending families takes time and effort. Of primary importance is a strong marital bond. The parents need to work together to create a new family of individuals who develop relationships with each other and their own family history. Gary's letter suggests that this is not happening. His envy and rivalry are divisive. He sees himself aligned with his children against his wife and her children. I would suggest to Gary that he concentrate on his marriage, that he make the relationship with his wife his focus. Then he and his wife can together tackle the tasks of relating to the other spouse's children, the financial differences, and the cultivation of connections in the reconfigured family. Sometimes, the best way to help our children is to get help for ourselves. If Gary can't get over his envy, rivalry, and depression, then he may need professional help. Susan. Terry is terrible. Dear Gail and Susan, my husband Terry buys his daughter, my stepdaughter Millie, anything she wants, which means that as a couple we have less money. Millie's mother doesn't work. She lives on alimony. I work and contribute financially to our lifestyle. I don't want to be a wicked stepmother, but shouldn't Terry see that although it's technically his money to give to Millie, Millie is in a way getting money from me too? I know neither one of them sees it that way, but don't you think that at the very least, she and Terry should be grateful to me? Zoe. Zoe, wife of Terry, stepmother of Millie, and provider of Terry's ex-wife. Ha! Do you really expect your husband's daughter to be grateful to you? And if you talk to Terry, will he be more grateful? I don't think so. He might cut down on what he gives Millie, but I doubt it. Sometimes fathers feel so guilty for leaving their child's mother, they try to make up for it by giving their children gifts. Sometimes they even give their ex-wives things. You would hate that, wouldn't you, Zoe? If you and your husband put your money into one pot, then you should have a say of what comes out of that pot. The problem is Terry has established a pattern with his daughter that won't easily go away. Why don't you open up a charge account at Saks Fifth Avenue, and every time your husband buys something for Millie, buy something for yourself? He'll start to worry about the bills, and you can suggest that both you and your stepdaughter cut back. If he won't cut back on Millie, he doesn't love you enough. Aren't you happy you wrote to us? Gail, who actually wants you to have more. Gail, I love your idea of a shopping spree followed by mutual agreement to rein in the spending. Very creative. The only problem with the solution is that it exacerbates the already existing rivalry Zoe feels toward her stepdaughter. I can understand Zoe's disappointment that she and Terry aren't making all the financial decisions together, including gifts to Millie. Parents should be the primary team. However, sometimes with blended families, for many reasons, that concept gets lost. As you suggest, Gail, Terry may feel guilty for having left his child and is trying to buy absolution from her. Terry may not know how to say no to his daughter. Perhaps Terry does not know how to parent and hopes to buy his way through it. Or Millie may want assurances that she will not be left the way her mother was, and controlling her father's money may make her think she's safe. Zoe has let her feelings of rivalry take hold of her. She is measuring her importance to her husband only in monetary terms. She needs to remind herself that Terry chose her as his partner, that she is his number one. Zoe also needs to remember that Millie has suffered a big loss, that Millie was sacrificed. I suggest that Zoe warmly include Millie in the new family and help her feel loved and secure. If Millie believes that she belongs, that she has not lost her dad, perhaps her need for things from him will abate. Susan. Blackjack loser. Dear Gail and Susan, my daughter Jenny gambles. She started online, now goes to casinos and plays blackjack. She's lost a lot of money, which has put the family in debt. Her husband is on the verge of leaving her. Should we lend her money to help her pay her bills and maybe save her marriage while she is trying to deal with her problem? Liz. Dear Lending Liz, haven't you heard that throwing money at a problem doesn't solve it? Don't feel badly if you haven't heard it. Our entire government apparently hasn't heard it either. Your daughter's husband is on the verge of leaving her. However, true addicts don't care about things on the verge. They only do something when they hit bottom. And you, her mother, have got to let her hit hard. Stay away with your checkbook. However, your daughter's husband can do something, and that is to close down all the credit cards, ATM card, and checking accounts, making sure the whole family doesn't hit bottom. Also, you can try to get Jenny to a Gamblers Anonymous meeting if you can. Gail, who always thought it would be a good idea to look for a husband at Gamblers Anonymous. They earned enough money to lose it in the first place, and now they're getting cured. I love your husband-hunting logic, Gail. Now to Liz's daughter and her gambling problem. Rule number one, never give addicts money. They will spend it on their addiction, guaranteed. Addicts in the grips of their problem do not make wise decisions. Addicts are secretive and they lie. So even if they say they will do the right thing with the money, they will spend it on their addiction. Liz's daughter needs to be in a program for gambling addiction. Her husband should find himself a support group where he will learn how to protect himself and his finances from his wife. Liz and her husband could join a support group as well. They all need ongoing help to cope with Jenny and her gambling. You are right, Gail. Jenny's access to money should be cut off if possible. Her credit cards and ATM cards should be confiscated. But in reality, addicts are very clever about meeting their needs for their drug. Addicts are self-destructive, so going more into debt, mixing with unsavory people to get money, or the threat of losing their marriage usually won't deter them. So, to best help her daughter, Liz should absolutely not give her money. As you say, Gail, she should take her to a Gamblers Anonymous meeting and hope that Jenny gets with the program. Susan. Gone with the inheritance. Dear Gail and Susan, if I don't buy my daughter Roz something she wants, she goes to her grandmother, my mother, who gets it for her. My mother just bought Roz a new car. Not only do I think that Roz at 35 should have bought her own car, but I'm also annoyed that the money is coming out of my inheritance. It's too against me and my family. Neither Roz nor my mother listens to me. Nancy Lynn. Nancy Lynn, Nancy Lynn. Tell your mother that she's spoiling your daughter. That's all you can do. She might not mind having a diminishing bank account. Try to remember, it's her money. It's not your inheritance while your mother is alive. So, what are you going to do? The only thing you can do in a case like this is write to us. And I can't be helpful. She's all yours, Susan. Gail. Who hates not coming up with the perfect answer. Thanks, Gail. I'll give it a try. Here are three generations of women acting out an interesting drama. Nancy Lynn is vying with her daughter for Grandma's money. Grandma is vying with her own daughter, Nancy Lynn, for Roz. And Roz is playing her mother and grandmother against each other. So rivalry is passed down from one generation to the other. It's their way of life. Nancy Lynn needs to extricate herself from the dynamic, not care what her mother does for Roz. If one player opts out, the game will stop. And you were right on an important issue, Gail. Nancy Lynn's inheritance isn't hers until her mother is dead and the will says she gets the money. Susan. Bernie, is frustrated. Dear Gail and Susan, my son Bernie is an engineer and has worked for years at a job that doesn't pay well. When I talk to Bernie on the phone, all I hear is that he is overworked, frustrated, and that he has very little time for a social life, let alone time to find a wife. He found one wife whom we all hated. My husband and I were so happy when she left. Bernie, who wanted her to go, still feels depressed that she left him. I feel that he should go on a vacation and have some fun. He says the divorce has left him broke. Bernie is in our will. I would like to pay for his vacation so I can see him enjoy our money while we're alive. My husband doesn't want to give Bernie a cent. Clarice. Dear, dear, soft Clarice, there seems to be a trend of giving offspring money when the parents are still alive so that the parents can see them enjoy it. In this case, Bernie has to spend the money the way you want him to. A trip might be nice, but he still has to face things when he gets home. He'll still be overworked, frustrated, and have very little time for a social life. Nothing will change. Unless he goes to the South Pacific and marries a native and stays there like Gauguin did, you and your husband should take a vacation. Gail, who has been to Gauguin land. Gail, Freud suggested that we should have satisfying work and personal lives to feel fulfilled and content. Bernie has neither. He left home and created an adult life, but it doesn't work. He doesn't like his job, didn't like his wife, and doesn't like being without her. Bernie's got a big problem. His mother wants to fix it with a little fun vacation. Bernie tries to tell Clarice how unhappy he is, but she doesn't see the scope and the depth of his troubles. I would tell Clarice to hear Bernie's complaints, not as a hustle for a free vacation, but as a cry for big picture clarity and serious answers. Bernie needs professional help. I hope that Clarice can get some perspective on Bernie's life and advise therapy. She might even offer to help pay for it. Susan. Susan, darling, I thought the person in therapy had to pay for it himself in order for the therapy to be effective. Gail. Gail, you are well informed. The thought is that unless a patient pays for therapy himself, he will not seriously do the work. For the most part, I adhere to that rule. In some cases, though, and Bernie's is one of them, I suggest that a parent help pay if the adult child really can't afford the whole fee. However, the child should make some financial sacrifice for his own treatment. Susan. Diamonds are not a girl's best friend. Dear Gail and Susan, I was widowed 10 years ago. It was hard on me for a few years, and I really leaned on my son Jeffrey. My problem is that since my husband died, Jeffrey has made a lot of money and insists on giving me gifts of expensive jewelry, and not understated expensive. I don't have the kind of life or circle of friends where I can wear these elaborate necklaces and rings. I've tried hinting that he should stop, but the diamonds and rubies keep coming. Should I just wear them, even though they make me uncomfortable? Should I talk to him and get him to take them back? I can't return them secretly because I couldn't keep the money. Please help me out of my dilemma. I love Jeffrey. Selma. Selma, oh, Selma, wear the jewelry and tell everybody it's fake. As far as talking to Jeffrey about taking the jewels back, why spoil his pleasure just because you are miserable with diamonds and rubies? Here's the deal. You say the loss of your husband was hard on you. It was hard on Jeffrey, too. Not only did he lose a father, he lost one of his shoulders because you were leaning on it. He feels more comfortable giving you presents so that he can have that shoulder back. Pay him back by reveling in his gifts. If you have such a simple lifestyle, maybe you're living too small a life. Put on all your jewels and take yourself to a nice restaurant once in a while. If you really don't want those precious gems, send them to me. Your BFF, Gail. When children are young, parents receive their gifts with great pleasure. They hang their scribbles as if they were Picasso's. They put the lopsided ashtrays on the coffee table. Children take delight in their parents' delight. The gifts represent what the child can do, who he is at the time. Jeffrey still likes to give his mom presents. Now he can afford expensive jewelry. That is who he is as an adult, a man of means and expensive taste. Perhaps he wants his mother to accept and enjoy the man of means he has become. Selma might question why she does not feel worthy of such lavishness. Rubies and diamonds are not usually a source of embarrassment, unless they are stolen. However, that being said, we can't control our adult children, not even the gifts they give. We need to accept graciously what they offer. Selma should receive the gifts in the generous spirit in which they are given. There is no mention in the letter that Jeffrey is married. If he marries, Selma's problem will be solved. Jeffrey will shower his wife with the jewels, and both Selma and Gail will be out of luck. Susan. From the Grave and Beyond. Dear Gail and Susan, my wife and I are in our 50s and doing our estate planning. We are not super rich, but I guess you would say we are sort of rich, so we have a sizable estate to leave. We have 3 children. One is super rich, one is rich, and the third is a teacher, so has a modest income and lifestyle. Our dilemma is how to divide up our estate. The teacher could use the money more than the others, but then again, they are each our children and for that are equal in our esteem. Do we divide the money equally or give more to the one who needs it more? Raymond. Listen, Raymond, if you have $3 million, divide it by 3. If you have $20,000, divide it by 3. You mentioned that the teacher has a modest income and lifestyle. Well, that's the life the teacher chose. What you don't want is one of the kids contesting the will. It probably will be the super rich one because he can afford a good lawyer. And you really don't want your family not to have each other when you're gone. Good parents make it possible for the siblings to support each other and enjoy each other even when you're no longer there. You may be the glue that holds them together now, but eventually they'll have to stick together on their own. An unbalanced will is likely to separate them, and then they won't have Christmas together when you've gone to heaven. P.S. You can put me in your will for giving you this advice. The fairest of them all, Gail. What you are talking about, Gail, is sibling rivalry. Parents sometimes think they can avoid this state of affairs in their family, but in reality, they cannot. They can, however, make sure that sibling rivalry among their children is resolved satisfactorily. Sibling rivalry is competition for parental love. A very young child believes that his parents' love is finite and that subsequent siblings take away love he has heretofore gotten. In reality, when a baby comes along, a mother does have to limit her time with the older children. To a child, this seems like proof he's lost mommy's love. In healthy families, parents help children develop strategies to assure affection without having to compete with each other. Parents facilitate each child's becoming his or her own individual person with unique strengths and talents. In this family's case, sibling rivalry seems to have been dealt with appropriately. Each child has developed his own career. Each is successful in his own right, despite the differences in earning power, related to the field chosen, not to competence. None of the children should be rewarded nor penalized for his career choice. Gail, you are correct. It is not about the money, but about the parents' affection for each child and validation of them as individuals. The estate should not be parceled out in terms of monetary need. It should indicate that the parents love each child equally and value and respect their life choices. Susan. Married a Bum. Dear Gail and Susan, my daughter Lila is divorced and has a little daughter, Amy, who is 1 year old. They both live with my husband and me. We were unhappy when our daughter married the bum she did, and we were right. He left right after Amy was born and has not paid the child support the court told him to pay. At the moment, we are completely supporting Lila and Amy. Our finances are stretched, but we're doing it. Should we continue to support them indefinitely? Reba. Dear burdened Reba, you should continue to let your daughter and granddaughter live with you. Little Amy deserves to have a male figure and a stable home in her life. But why can't Lila go out and work like the rest of us while Amy is napping or asleep at night? And why can't she report the deadbeat dad? It sounds as though Lila has become a child again. I feel badly for you. You were unhappy when she married a bum, and it seems you're unhappy now. However, I doubt that kicking them out will make you any happier. Tell Lila she has to work to pay for her and her daughter's expenses. You and your husband should give Amy as much love and stability as possible. Bleeding heart, Gail. Gail, I respectfully disagree. Let me tell you why. This letter is about an adult daughter, Lila, who seems to irresponsibly drift through life, and her parents allow it. An easy problem to see, but not an easy one to fix. Ideally, Reba should help Lila make a plan that includes the following: a trip to the district attorney's office to file charges against the deadbeat dad, a reasonable deadline for Lila to get a job and move out to a place of her own, enrollment for Amy at an inexpensive daycare center. Reba can offer a gift of first and last month's rent and/or pay for daycare to help Lila get started. As I said, easier said than done. These family patterns were probably established a long time ago. I would strongly recommend that they find a therapist to help them, either a family therapist or an individual therapist to help Lila grow up and take responsibility, and/or a therapist for Reba to learn how to set limits and foster Lila's independence. Most communities have clinics with a sliding fee scale. The local phone book is a place to start. Without professional help, there could very well be more bum marriages and more children Lila can't take care of. Susan. Dealing drugs. Dear Gail and Susan, my 24-year-old son Cal smokes pot. I don't like it, but his friends all do it, and he has a job and an apartment, so I couldn't really say anything. But Cal, along with a friend, got arrested for dealing. Cal needs a lawyer and says he can't afford one. Do we pay for a good lawyer or let a public defender take his case? Thelma. Thelma, 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 your son should rot in jail. Smoking pot is not a good idea because it dulls the senses and ruins the brain. It is now known that the brain continues to develop until you're 25. Smoking pot limits that development. Dealing drugs is disgusting. Picture this. Your son Cal buys the dope from some scumbag standing on a corner in a bad neighborhood where scumbags gather. That's probably how he got caught. Then picture him selling the drug to his friends. Finally, picture him waiting outside a schoolyard so he can broaden his business by selling to children. How do you feel about Cal saying things like, "The first one is free," to an 11-year-old? You've got to let this son of yours drown. Don't pay for a good lawyer. Public defenders with big stomachs and shiny suits are good enough and are used to representing dealers. Let your son have consequences for his behavior. And by the way, you could have said something when you first saw him smoking, even though he had a job and an apartment. I can only imagine that the reason you didn't say a word was because you were getting a contact high. Gail, a non-smoker. Gail, Cal may have the trappings of independence, but true independence means that the consequences of your choices are your own. He has chosen to break the law, yet wants his mother to fix it for him. He wants his pot and his mommy, too. Cal has a job, so he should be able to afford to pay for his own lawyer, But if he can't, then I agree with you, Gail. He should put himself in the hands of a public defender. Cal wants the easy fix, whether it is dealing dope or having someone else pay. Thelma does her son no favor by helping him out. It is time for Cal to deal with his serious problem of criminality. Having to face the consequences of his actions is his only hope of avoiding a lifetime of hard time. Susan. And everything else. Dear Gail and Susan, I have a problem that I am embarrassed to ask you about, but my wife pushed me to do it, so here goes. My wife and I are in our 80s, and although I worked until I was 70 and have a pension, with the price of medications and everything else, we are struggling. Our son is a lawyer and makes a good living. He is married to a nice woman. They have 2 children, 1 in college and 1 in high school. My wife and I would like to approach my son and daughter-in-law and ask if they could help us out financially. Whatever they could spare would take some of the stress off us. Should we ask, and if so, how should we do it? Barton. My dear embarrassed Barton, I feel for you. Have you done everything possible to lower the costs of your Medicare medications and everything else? Have you figured out Medicare? Walmart fills prescriptions for $4 or $5. Are you cutting coupons? Have you heard about reverse mortgages and how they work? The bank pays you, usually a hefty amount, and then they own your house. But here's the good part. You can live there until the day you die. If you've done everything you can, it's all right to go to your son and daughter-in-law. It's very thoughtful and correct to include her. It's their money. Prepare for the meeting. Write down every expenditure you have, and I mean down to chewing gum. Since your son is a lawyer, he'll appreciate that. Start by saying that you know they're at a point in life where their expenses are high. Mention in your discussion that you're aware of what it costs to send children through college these days. The amount you ask for should be very modest, just enough for you to cover your basic expenses. Ask them if they have any ideas that you might have overlooked in trying to balance your budget. Finally, make sure you tell them that they shouldn't make a decision right there on the spot. Give them time to talk about it when you're not around. It won't hurt to tell them you'll love them in any case. Good luck. Practical, Gail. I like your answer, Gail. Barton and his wife should ask both their son and daughter-in-law to participate in a realistic money discussion. We need to remember that our adult married children have their own families. We are no longer their primary family, nor their primary concern. Any money that goes to Barton's parents will affect Barton's son's own family. Barton should assume that his son will make a responsible decision, which might be to not give Barton money. In other words, the goal should be for Barton to find a way to relieve his financial strain, not to manipulate his son into an obligation. Susan. Medically inept. Dear Gail and Susan, my 28-year-old son Michael lives at home. He has no job at the moment, although he says he's looking for one. Because he doesn't work, he can't afford medical insurance. Frankly, my husband and I.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.